Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
I'm going to get down on my knees in just a moment. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to be our teacher. As we do, I'm going to ask if you're able to stand, would you just join me? Let's stand together. Let's prepare our hearts to hear the Word of God this morning. Father, we just come before you. Lord, we're just, first and foremost, we're just so grateful for the opportunity that we have to be here on this Thanksgiving week. Lord, we thank you that we just have the freedom to come and to worship you without fear of persecution, without having to look over our shoulder as we glorify your name. Lord, that's just such a blessing right there in itself. God, we don't come into this house to hear from a man, to hear from a woman. Lord, we don't come to hear from the old or from the young. Lord, we don't come for tradition or even for entertainment. We come to hear from you, and we fully acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this church. And it's in the name of Jesus we ask that, Lord, your Holy Spirit would be our teacher today. Holy Spirit, we invite you in to be our counselor, to be our guidance. As we get into the Word of God, I pray that you would just open it and reveal it to us, Lord, and show us in our lives what we ought to do to follow you closely. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we know that there's just so much you've done for us here. God, we don't ask these blessings upon ourselves, but upon all the brothers and sisters around the world and even around the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we don't ever think of ourselves as better or higher than anybody else. But rather, we are co-laborers in the body of Christ. So Lord, to all our churches and all our neighbors that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ today, we ask you would bless them as you have blessed us. Lord, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and our Adventist brothers and sisters, our denominational brothers and sisters such as the Baptists and the Presbyterians, the Lutheran, Methodist, Episcopalian, Foursquare. Lord, we thank you for the local churches in the area, churches like Harvest and the Grove. Lord, we thank you for Sandals and the Well and the Way. Lord, for Water of Life, for Emmanuel Baptist, for Victory, for Abundant Living. Lord, all the churches, so many of them, too many to name today, but Lord, we thank you, God, that you would bless them, our Calvary Chapel brothers and sisters. Lord, encourage them, strengthen them, guard them as we ask you to do that with us. And Lord, to you be the praise, to you be the glory, to you be the honor. Lord, we pray that your kingdom come, your will be done on earth, Lord, as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name. We all said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, as you're grabbing your seat, get your Bible out, get your phone out, get your device out, whatever it is that you get into the Word of God, get it out, open it up, get it ready, because we are going to use it today. Amen. We're going through the book of Hebrews line upon line, precept upon precept, and today we're in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Real exciting news. We've got one more weekend after this week, and then we're finding ourselves in the month of December. We're going to take a sidestep after that, and we're going to get into Hebrews chapter number 11, beginning the first part of the year. And that's exciting. The reason that's exciting is that kind of has this unofficial title of the Hall of Faith. I mean, this is all about faith. We're going to get into Hebrews chapter. I'm excited about it. I went to school in Oklahoma for one subject, faith, and I tell you, it was awesome. And I'm just excited about that. Today we're at Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Also want to take a quick moment to welcome everybody who's watching online around the United States, around the world. Hey, we're honored to have you joining us online at your home or on your phone or wherever it might be. If you're ever in town, come check us out. We'd love to get to know you personally and meet you one-to-one. So we'd love to have you, but we're just glad that you're joining with us today. Here we are in Hebrews in the 10th chapter. I need to do something. I need to ask you before we even begin. I got to just say, you need to put your thinking caps on today. All right? Can you do that for me? Because we're going to get into the Word, and we're going to get into some Scripture. We're going to talk about some things, and I believe that this, what we're going to talk about today, is huge. This is of great magnitude and of importance to you and I in our relationship with God, and we got to get there, got to be on the same page. So buckle up your seatbelts, put your thinking caps on, and I'll tell you what, we're going to get into the Word, and it's going to be great. I know for a fact. Hebrews in the 10th chapter, verse number 36, is where we've kind of been hanging out for the past couple of weeks. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36 says, "For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise." We talked about endurance and long-suffering. In verse number 37, it goes quoting the Old Testament, "For yet a little while, he who is coming will come and will not tarry." Pastor Jim talked about the coming of the Lord. Verse number 38, we talked a little bit about this. Verse number 38 says, "Now the just shall live by faith." Now we're going to kind of move beyond this subject in order to come back to it in a couple of weeks when we look at Hebrews, the 11th chapter, kind of like we did when we looked at Melchizedek in Hebrews, the 7th chapter. We had read about him previously in the previous chapters, but the 7th chapter really gave us a deeper understanding, much like the subject of faith in the 11th chapter does. So we're going to look beyond that today, and we're going to look at this one. The second part of verse 38 says, "But if anybody draws back my soul," this is the words of the Lord speaking to his people, says, "my soul has no pleasure in him." And I tell you what, that's a sobering statement. That's a real kind of shocking statement, that here the word of the Lord to his people says, man, if you draw back, my soul, the very fiber of my being, has no pleasure in you. Man, that's just something that ought to shock us into waking up for something. But I love what verse number 39 says. Verse number 39 repeats this again and says, "But we are not those who draw back to perdition." So we've talked about this in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews in the 6th chapter talked about those having been impossible, those who have tasted and walked away. And then again in Hebrews in the 10th chapter, those who have accepted the sacrifice and continue on. It's impossible. There's not another sacrifice after Jesus. And so we've discussed the subject of walking away, or of turning away, or of turning aside. And today I love this exhortation to the church. The author of the Hebrews gives us that we aren't those who draw away. So that leads us to the conclusion that we are those who draw near. Because in terms of your relationship with God, there's really only two positions that you can have in your relationship with God. You're either drawing close or you're drawing away. Let me say that. There's actually three standings you can have with God. One is that you're drawing close to God. Secondly, you're remaining stationary or stagnant in your relationship. Or third, you're actually drawing away or walking away. But if you imagine, because of the time, it's like a line or an arrow being shot out in a trajectory that it continually moves forward. So as you're moving forward, you are moving forward at the pace of that time progressing. If you are moving back, you are moving the opposite direction. But if you are remaining stationary, as that time progresses, that line grows longer, your position from that moving line draws further and further and further away. So actually, you're drawing back by not going forward. So the Bible says in Hebrews that you and I, the church, the body of Christ, we are not those who draw back to perdition or to trouble. Literally, some translations say that we are not those who shrink back as though something happens and we kind of shrink or shrivel back, but we are those who press forward. So today I don't want to talk about drawing back and the consequences of that. I believe that we've covered that throughout the book of Hebrews on several occasions. So today I want to talk about drawing close. The title of this morning is Drawing Close. And today I want to look at what it means for you and I to draw close. Now, I'm not going to give you four thoughts on how to draw close. Let me tell you why I'm not going to give you four thoughts on how to draw close. Because we sang a song. I thought it was a pretty cool song. You are God alone. From before time began, that's just the way it is. Your plan, right? So that kind of puts us in our place. You see, God did something to humanity when he created it. He created on the inside of humanity a longing for something more than just existence. There was a longing, a connection. Adam and Eve experienced this connection with God. But because of the sin nature, or the nature of humanity, we have this disconnect by birth from God. Therefore, there's this longing to draw, to seek after something. Some people find it from God. Some people find it from answers, philosophies, ideas, or thoughts, or religions, or whatever have you. But there's something on the inside of mankind that we yearn for a reason to live, and that was placed in us by God. So how do we draw close to God? By understanding, by knowing God, literally brings us to a place of drawing close to God. Jesus says that I will draw all peoples unto me. We don't need to know how to draw unto God. That's God's already done that with us. He's already instilled that on the inside of us. Today I want to look at four subjects, four categories of what could hinder our drawing close to God. But at the same time, these four categories could not only hinder us, but if we look at them the right way, they can actually help us or direct us into drawing close to God. So today I want to do that, and I'm not going to give you a cliffhanger. I'm not going to leave you hanging on what these four subjects are. I'll just tell you right now. Over the past couple of weeks, as I've been studying and preparing for today, as we laid out where we were going with Hebrews in the 10th chapter, I felt the Spirit of God just really impressed upon my heart these four things, and as we were writing them down, and these four subjects that we're going to talk today about, things that can help or can hinder us drawing close to God are these four words. These four words are this: fear, knowledge, religion, and self. Fear, knowledge, religion, and self. Now, right off the bat, we look at these words and we think, man, I can totally see how these type of things would keep us kind of away from God. You know, like religion's kind of like, oh, I don't know about that. Self, yeah, that makes sense. We're selfish, you know, fear. But today, if we get a good understanding, a right understanding of these categories, these topics, these subjects, I believe that we'll begin to see how they really draw us in to the presence of God. And this is so huge, and we'll talk about the magnitude of that towards the end. But today, let's just look at these four thoughts, these four categories, these four words, and I'll just give you the words, and then we'll just kind of give a little description of what that means, that word means for you and I. The first one we'll talk about, since it's the first one on the list there, is fear. Fear literally kind of translates to how we see or view God. How do we view God? So fear can draw us away or it can draw us close. As we read in the Bible, the word fear can have several meanings. Can literally mean to be afraid of, like I'm afraid of snakes. Or it can mean to revere or respect or reverence, as though I have this respect for something, for God. So which is it? Does it mean that I'm afraid of God, or does it mean that I respect God? Well, the answer is both. Literally, it means to have a fear of the Lord, the Bible says. And it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. So there is this two sides of the coin to fear. But when we have an understanding of what the fear of the Lord means to you and I in the body of Christ, in terms of drawing close, it really helps to bring us and put us into a place where we understand who God is. If you've got your Bibles, you can turn with me to 2 Corinthians in the 7th chapter. Maybe you thumb there or you use your phone, whatever it might be. The verse will also be there on the overhead as well. 2 Corinthians in the 7th chapter is a really interesting statement. Paul the Apostle is writing to the church and he says this. He says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves. Very interesting statement. We'll talk about that in a little while. Cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit. Lowercase s, speaking of our spirit man. Perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. So you see, in order for us to perfect holiness, to be like God, to have this right standing or righteousness of God, we have to do so operating in the fear of the Lord. But the problem that you and I are discussing is that fear can literally draw us away from God. When we're afraid, it can cause us to shy away, to turn away, to look away. Think of it like this, Adam and Eve in the garden. You recall the story when Eve took the fruit and Adam ate the fruit, and then God says, hey, where are you guys at? They were hiding. And why are you hiding? God asks them. I'm paraphrasing. And they said, well, we realized that we were naked and we were afraid. In the Exodus, as the Hebrews are going through the wilderness, the presence of God descends upon the mountain and they see the presence of God and they literally shied away because they were afraid of what might happen to them. We sang that song, Oceans, today, the story of Peter on the water. Peter, when he was walking on the water, saw the wind and the waves, and he was afraid, and it caused his faith to begin to fail, and he began to sink. So fear can literally cause us to shy away. But at the same time, reverence, respect can actually bring us close. It can actually draw us in, much like somebody who has something to say, somebody who's studied, or somebody who's well-renowned, a person that's famous, and you want to hear what they have to say. What do they have to say about this? They're the foremost authority on the subject. You want to draw close. You want to understand what they're saying, and that's what reverence does. It literally brings us to a place of wanting to know more, wanting to draw in. Let me give you an example like this. I have a table saw. I do the woodworking thing. I talk about it a lot. I do the woodworking thing in my home, in my garage, and I have this thing called a table saw. Every year in the United States, 35,000 people suffer amputations from table saws alone. Pretty crazy number. 35,000 people cut a digit off on a table saw. That's what that means. You know what that means for me? That means that I have a reason to be afraid. Why? That sucker could cut my finger off. But I don't have to be afraid of it. Why? Because I have a reverence or a respect for it. I understand what it could do if I don't respect the machine. But I also see that there's a benefit. Therefore, I don't shy away because of my fear. I realize that machine helps me to accomplish the task that I've set before me. Therefore, as I treat it with respect, I go about the safety. As a matter of fact, I've got this piece of wood that I was one time being lazy about it, and it caught on the blade, and the blade shot it right back at me and hit me in the stomach, gave me a big old bruise. I took a big Sharpie on that piece of wood, wrote across that, "Kickback hurts." That's what it's called, kickback, when a piece of wood comes flying back at you. It's right there over where my table saw is at. Why? So that every time I turn that on, I look at that piece of wood and I remember that if I don't respect it, I'm going to get sloppy. And if I get sloppy and cut corners, that puts me in a position of danger where I am at risk of suffering injury. It's the same exact thing in our relationship and our walk with God. When we respect God, we reverence God, then we see that there's a way to approach. There's a way that we operate. There's a way that we live our lives, as it says, walking out their lives in the fear of the Lord. But when we lose that respect, when we lose that reverence, we become sloppy in our Christianity. And when we get sloppy in our Christianity, we let things come in and affect us. And we begin to rationalize God and bring God from the level that He is down to our level. And we begin to try to make things, okay, well, you know, well, if God was really just, it would be like this. And if God was that, and well, why didn't God do it like, well, if I was it, I would have done this. And all of a sudden we begin to bring God down to our own level. And what we're doing is we're literally removing or operating in the lack of fear of God, and that puts us like working with that machine in a place where we can suffer consequence. And think of it like this: well, what about being afraid of God? The Bible says to be afraid of God. They here are perfecting holiness in the fear of God. But did you know that when you are in the presence of God, when you are drawing close to God, in relationship with God, in covenant connection with God, you do not have to be afraid. You know why? Are you afraid of getting a speeding ticket on the freeway if you're going the speed limit? No, but if you drive fast, you buy that radar scanner. You're looking in the mirror, looking around the bush. Is there a cop there? I've seen him there before. Why? Because you know you're not operating in the right of the law. So when we are operating with God, seeking after God, reverencing and respecting the position that God has in our lives, then we don't have to be afraid. But when we get sloppy, when we start rationalizing, when we start operating in our own desires, then all of a sudden things begin to change. That's when it becomes important for you and I. As a matter of fact, it says it right here in Acts, the 9th chapter. This is a really neat verse about the early church. Acts, the 9th chapter, in the 31st verse, it says this. It says, "Then the churches throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace and were edified." Man, I don't know about you. I want peace and edification in my life. Amen. Okay, I guess I'm alone. And we're walking in the fear of the Lord. How can you be afraid but have peace and edification? They were walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. They had a right understanding of God, and because of that, they were operating according to the will of God, and therefore they had a reverence, but they did not have to be afraid. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God when you turn away. But when we have an understanding that God, you are God alone. God, you won't be me, and God, I will never be you. Then all of a sudden we begin to realize, God, you're God, and I am me. And now when I begin to say, God, you're in control, I realize, hey, guess what? God is really in control. It may be I thought it could have been this way or it could have been that way. Doesn't matter. It's not my way. It's God's way. When we're close to God, in reverence, we don't need to be afraid. But when we begin to rationalize and when we get sloppy, guess what? Consequences follow. The second thought we talked about, that things that would draw us away or bring us to, is this subject or this word knowledge. Knowledge literally means something like this: what we listen to. What we listen to. Now, I'm not going to tell you as Christians, you should know about, you know, science and math and all those things. Man, that's bad. That'll philosophy, all these, man, that'll mess you all up, man. You Christians, we just need to remain ignorant and no, that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is this, is that when we begin to think we know everything, we lose our reliance on God. When we begin to think that we know everything, we lose our reliance on God. You see, it's like this. The knowledge of man seeks to exalt itself or raise itself above God. The knowledge of man seeks to exalt itself above God. We see this again in the book of Genesis in the fall. When Eve had the fruit, the Bible says that she saw that it was good and pleasurable to eat and that it was able to make one wise. The Tower of Babel in Genesis 11 chapter says, they said, let us gather together and build a tower and the top will be up in the heavenly places. We'll be exalted high above and we will be like God. 2 Corinthians in the 10th chapter, as Paul tells us about the weapons of our warfare, tells us that they're not carnal or fleshly, but they're literally mighty spiritually. And that we cast down every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of Christ. So the knowledge of man seeks to elevate itself above God. So when we search the knowledge of men, what we're looking for is an answer outside of God. An answer outside of God. But the problem is, there is no definitive answer outside of God. There is no definitive answer outside of God. You know, some might say, you say it like this, well, you know, well, science has proven or math has proven this or has proven that. You know, 1 + 1 is mathematically proven to be 2. Yes, definitively to the knowledge of man, yes. But if God wants to change the formula, God is capable. Why? Because there is no definitive answer outside of God. The knowledge of man seeks to remove God. The problem is there is no answers in there. Let me show you examples. If there was, why have we not cured cancer? Why have we not figured out how to solve climate change? Why haven't we figured out why Earth could be a utopia? Why haven't we figured out how to make every person on Earth not suffer with hunger or world hunger? Why haven't we figured out the issues over here? Why can't we have peace in the Middle East or in North Korea? What's going on? If men could answer those questions, then why haven't we? Because the answers are not definitive with men, they're only with God. Solid with God. Ephesians in the 4th chapter, you can go there because we'll read a couple of verses. Ephesians in the 4th chapter, Paul the Apostle is talking to the church, a real amazing statement here, talking about the knowledge, understanding of men. Ephesians the 4th chapter, verse number 17, Paul the Apostle says, Therefore I say, and testify in the Lord that you, who's you? You and I. That you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles or the outsiders walk, those who are not within Christianity, in the futility of their minds, having their understanding darkened, he says in verse number 18, being alienated from the life of God. Why? Because of the ignorance that is in them. Pretty interesting statements. Because of the blindness of their heart. And he goes on, he says, who being past feeling have given themselves to lewdness and to work all cleanliness with greediness. Look what he says. But he says, verse number 20, but you have not so learned in Christ. You have not so learned Christ. Why? He goes on, verse number 21, he says, but if you have heard him and have been taught by him, who? Jesus. As the truth is in Jesus. He goes on and he says this in verse number 22. That you put off concerning the old or the former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust. In verse number 23, he says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. I'm not saying that science is bad, that math is bad, that these thoughts are bad. I'm not going there. I'm not saying Christians shouldn't be involved in that. I love science. I was just asking Dr. Kobernick, one of our pastors, because he's a chemistry teacher, explain to me oxygenated water, because I really want to know the chemistry of it. I love it. But when we look to science for answers beyond or beside or apart from God, we will find no definitive answers. But when we realize that things point to God, that science points to God, that mathematics points to God, when we realize that there's an answer that points to God, now all of a sudden the knowledge of the more we know we need God, brings us to God and draws us close. Critics of Christianity oftentimes will say to Christians, man, you just God is just a crutch for you to lean on. Because you can't come to a logical conclusion or a reasonable assessment of why this or that has happened. You have no answers. Therefore, by default, by your crutch that you lean on, you say, God. Yeah! Hello! Because I don't know about you, I don't have all the answers. And the more I know, the more I realize I need God because He has the answers. Are you with me this morning? Call it a crutch. That's cool. I got a limp in my knowledge and I need a crutch to lean on. I'm okay with that. So when we realize that knowledge can draw us to God, then we have to realize that we can't continue searching the knowledge of men hoping to find the answers that we can only find in God. Which means that we've got to spend our time not searching the knowledge of men for our answers, but searching the knowledge and the Word of God. Let me say it like this. Stop wasting your time reading the self-help books. You know why? They don't work. Here's why they don't work. You know why they don't work? Because there's a new one every month. Every day is this day, a new day tomorrow, a new you, a new life. And every one of them claims to have the way to do it. But if they worked, then somebody would have written the book and it would have already been written and it would have worked and everybody would own the book. It does not work. That's why every week, every month, there's a new self-help book out. Stop reading that stuff. It's not about what Oprah, Dr. Phil, Dr. Oz, Queen Latifah says, the ladies on The View. The knowledge of God. There is a self-help book that has been written. It's the consistent, hasn't changed. But it begins by us searching this rather than the knowledge and the understanding and the writings of men. That's when we begin to draw close to God. Man, I'll tell you, what a thought. Now, the third thought, moving forward. The third thought that can draw us close or take us away from God. This is a big one. Religion. Dun, dun, dun. No, religion, that's not about that. Religion tells us, what are we looking for? Religion appeases humanity's desire to know, what do I have to do to be good? Just tell me what I got to do and let me try to do it. And then religion comes along and says, all right, these are the rules, these are the not, these are the do's, the don'ts, the must, thous, the thou shalt not. And then guess what happens? We break them. And then we go back and we say, well, now what do I do in order to get right again? Well, these are the thou shalt and thou shalt nots. And we do those and we break those. So we look at this thing of a religion, oh man, that's a bunch of people, it's a bunch of hypocrites, whatever people say about it can draw us away from God. But you see, Christianity is not about, well, tell me what I got to do and then I'll do it. Christianity is literally a transformation of the physical and the spiritual person that we are into something that Jesus Christ has designed us to be. I had a young man in one of our young adult service ask me, Pastor Luke, man, how do we know? How do we know that Christianity is the real one, the right one, the right choice? As if there's an option of books on a shelf and that by means of choosing Christianity, we kind of just picked it and said, well, this is the right one. How do we know? And I said, man, the answer is incredibly simple and also incredibly complex. But I said, let me give you the simple answer. And he was like, yeah, man, that's what I want. Simple answer is this. How do we know Christianity is the real, the true, the real religion, if you want to call it that, or if you want to say it like that? How do we know? Here's how. Because when we get into Jesus, something happens on us, not just about where we go when we die. That's incredibly important. But something happens right now while we live. And it's called life, an abundant life as Jesus promised. You see, the power of Christ comes on the inside of us and we begin to experience and see and feel there is a change in us that did not happen until I met Jesus. The complexity is that we get so wrapped up in the title. We get so wrapped up in the religion that we say, well, I've met Jesus, but now tell me, what do I need to do and what do I need to not do in order to be like Him? And all of a sudden we get wrapped up in religion and we begin to lose the power of Christ that changes us to be like Him. The early church had this. They understood this. They got this. And in the first couple of hundred years, they followed, Jesus! They followed Jesus, the man Jesus. They followed him. They were so allied to Jesus. Their allegiance was so much to Jesus that the Romans were threatened because they loved Jesus more than Caesar. What kind of man is this Jesus? They followed Jesus. And then as years progressed and as Christianity grew and it became an institution in the Roman Empire, which is long since gone, all of a sudden it grew from following Jesus to becoming an institution. And then they began to follow the rules. Well, do this and don't do this and pray this many times. And if you walk this many miles or if you do this or if you do that, then God will forgive. God will do this. You'll be blessed. You'll be saved. They got their eyes off of following Jesus because religion shows us who or what are we looking for. And now they say, well, the things that you read in the book of Acts, in the Bible, the New Testament, that's not for the church today. That was only for the early church. Could it be that they don't experience the power that the early church saw because they are no longer looking at Jesus, but now they're looking at institution, rules, regulations, and religion? Man, if we could grab a hold of that very thought, imagine what our lives would be like. Imagine what our lives would be like. Paul the Apostle in Romans in the 7th chapter, if you got your Bibles there, go with me because we're going to look at some verses in Romans in the 7th chapter. Romans chapter 5, Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 7. Paul is talking about the law, religion, rules and regulations. Thou shalt not. The law served a purpose to tell us how imperfect we were. And so Paul, at the end of Romans, the 7th chapter, is giving this discourse on the state of humanity, realizing that there is a war, a battle of the law of the man and the law in the heart. And he says this in Romans, at the end of Romans, the 7th chapter, we'll just go ahead and put it on the overhead, verse number 24, Paul says, oh, wretched man that I am. Man, I'll tell you, I've looked at myself in the mirror a couple of times in my life and said, God, I'm such a wretched guy. Paul the Apostle says, oh, wretched man that I am. Look what he says, so important. Who will save me or deliver me from this body of death? You catching that? Who, not what? He didn't say, what? Is it Islam? Is it Buddhism? Is it Christianity? Is it Taoism? Is it Confucianism? Is it whatever? It's not a what, it's a who. Religion is about what are we looking for? And Paul the Apostle acknowledges that it's not a what that saves us, it's a who. And then he goes on in verse number 1 of the 8th chapter, and he says, there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ. A lot of the modern messages of churches stop at that and say, well, because we're in Christ, there's no more conviction of sin. There's a period, not a comma. There's a comma, not a period. Look what it says. To those who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. When you are in Christ, it's like driving the speed limit on the freeway. You don't have to worry about getting a speeding ticket. Therefore, there's no condemnation. But it's not about what do I do, what do I not do, what do I do, what do I not do. That's called walking according to the flesh. Look what it says in verse number 5. We'll jump a couple verses down. He says this. He says, those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, religion, law. But those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit of God, drawing close to God. Look what he goes on. He says in verse number 10, skipping a couple verses more, he says, and if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness, not because of you, because of your flesh, because of Christ. Now, this is what's awesome. Look at verse number 11. But the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit who dwells in you. Jesus is in us. What this means, we on our own do not work. Following the rules and regulations of the law, do this or do not, does not work. We can't live up to it. But because of the Spirit that dwells in us, if Christ is in us, we are quickened, raised up, made alive in Christ, and now we are able, capable to move beyond the rules and the regulations. It's not about a what shall I and what shall I not do, but now it's about Jesus. It's about Jesus. The awareness of our sins makes us shy away from God, but the awareness that we are no longer living life alone brings us to God. Our sin awareness draws us away from God, but realizing that we are no longer captive to our sin nature because Jesus Christ died on the cross and the Bible says that we are crucified with Him, now all of a sudden realize we have this power that is on the inside of us to do something different than ever been done in our lives before, and that's Jesus. You see, religion says this. Religion says, read a biography about a man and do the best you can to be like him. Christianity says this. Don't just read a biography about a man. Get to know him. Hang out with him. Spend time in your life with him. You know why? Because who you hang out with, you become like. Pastor Dan and I were talking. We were talking on Wednesday, and he says, man, I couldn't figure it out. We were talking about Dad. We were talking about you, Dad. He says, man, I can't figure it out. All these people were coming up to me, and Pastor Dan was telling me, he says, man, everybody was coming up to me and saying, hey, listen, I got to talk. Hey, listen, we got to talk. And he says, man, somebody so-and-so would come up to me and be like, hey, man, we got to talk. And he's kind of like, I caught on after a while. Like, everybody's saying, hey, listen. Where did hey, listen come from? Well, we realized, oh, they're hanging out with Dad. And every time Dad wants to talk to us, Pastor Jim talks to us, he calls, hey, Luke, how's it going? Hey, listen, I wanted to tell you something. Hey, listen. Hey, and so as you begin to hang out with somebody, you begin to talk. Why? Because we rub off. So as we spend time with Christ, drawing close, he begins to rub off on us a little bit. Rub off a little bit over here. He begins to rub off a little bit over there and rub off a little bit. And all of a sudden, it's not trying to be like him, but now all of a sudden, him rubbing off on us and we are becoming like him. Why? Because we're drawing close to him. Wow. Huge, huge when we think about what that really means for us in our walks with God. The last thing that draws us closer takes us away in our relationship with Jesus. The last one is self. How can self bring us to God? Self is realizing our condition. Selfishness, self-desire, pride, the lust of the flesh, so forth and so on, that draws us away from God. No question about that. As a matter of fact, in 1 Peter the 5th chapter, real familiar verses, 1 Peter, the 5th chapter, he exhorts the church. He says this. He says, likewise, you younger people, does anybody have teenagers? You know, those of you who are raising your hand, you know without a doubt that they don't know, or they will admit they don't know anything. You chuckle, and it's kind of setting in because you're like, no, wait a minute, no. My teenager knows everything. Peter's talking to young, he says, you younger people, because you know it all. Submit yourself to your elders. It's not about you. It's not about your self-reliance. It's not about, well, I'm an island to myself. I can do this on my own. It's all about me, myself, and I. He says, submit yourself to your elders. But he doesn't take it just to the young people. He says, and you, everybody, all of you, be submissive to one another. Why? To realize that you cannot do this alone. And when you realize that you cannot do this alone, you become aware of the self. You become aware, self-aware, you can say it like that, to realize that there is something that you have got to lean on. And look what he says in verse number 6. He says, God resists the proud, gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Realizing it's not about me. It's not about my ability. It's not about my knowledge. It's not about how good looking or not good looking. It's not about how smart or not smart. It's not about, you know, like I'll survive. It's not about that. It's about realizing I cannot do this on my own. By examining ourselves, by looking at our condition, we realize that we can't help ourselves. We can't fix ourselves. We can't make ourselves good enough. And when we come to our senses and begin to realize that, that puts us in a position to begin to draw near to God through Christ Jesus, because we realize that He can help us, that He can fix us, that He makes us good enough, but not on our own, but through Jesus Christ today. Jesus gives a really cool story in Luke the 15th chapter. You know, it's called the prodigal son. Jesus says there's a young man, he goes to his father and he says, Dad, I want my inheritance. I'm going to go do my own thing. I got my own plans. I don't want to be around here. I'm going to do my thing. And so his father gives him his portion of the inheritance. And he goes, and the Bible says that he spends his money on lavish living and revelries and all sorts of different things. And he loses everything he has, and he finds himself sleeping with the pigs, eating out of their trough for food. And the Bible says in the 17th verse during this parable of Luke, the 15th chapter, he says, then he came to himself. He came to the self-understanding that I cannot make my life any better. It's not about me. It's not about myself. It's not about I. It's not about my money, my abilities, my thoughts, my life. There's something bigger than me. And when he came to himself, he realized, man, the people that work for my dad have a better life than I do right now. I'll go ask my dad for a job. Some of y'all might want to think about that one too. His self-awareness brought him to a position of realizing he needed something beyond himself. He went back to his dad. Our self-awareness to realize that we need something beyond our own ability to get through life brings us to a place of seeking after, of drawing close to Jesus. Because we know we can't fix ourselves. We know we can't make ourselves better. We know that we have no power to improve our own lives beyond the materialistic things of this world. But Jesus is able and capable to do so with us. So when we look deep into ourselves and when we realize that it's not about us or our own behalf, that's when life improves through Jesus. The conclusion of today is, man, okay, Pastor Luke, well, fear can take me away or bring me in. Knowledge can take me away or bring me in. Religion can take me away or bring me in. Self can take me away or bring me in. I feel like I'm walking a tightrope. Which one is it? Yeah. Jesus said that the path is narrow. It is. A decision. What am I going to do? Am I going to choose to seek the knowledge of men because it's interesting? Or am I going to seek God? Am I going to choose to respect and reverence and fear God? Or am I going to choose to do my own thing and rationalize because it makes sense to my own mind, the futility of my mind? Am I going to choose to just ask, well, what do I have to do in order to be good? Or am I going to say, I want to get more into Jesus and let Him do something in me? Am I going to say, well, I can do this on my own. Nobody's ever helped me in life. Why would I ask for help now? Or are we going to say, man, there's something about my life that I can't fix and somebody else has got to help me out? It is a tightrope, but as you begin to walk, the road becomes more broad. The answer becomes more clear. Why? Because as you get into Jesus, as you get into God, as you draw near, you get more of God. And as you get more of God, you get more of the presence of God. You get more of the power of God. You get more of the understanding of God. You get more of the relationship from God. Think of it like this in a rainstorm, holding an umbrella. The higher the umbrella is, the smaller the shadow is on you. If rain comes from the side, it'll get you. But the closer you bring that umbrella to you, the closer you get into that umbrella, when it's raining hard and you hunker down and you hold that thing as close as you can get it, the more the shadow, the rain shadow has over you, the more covering you are. It's the same thing with God. That's why I say this is huge. This is the answer to every question in your life. Well, I can't. What about that sin I can't escape? What about my kids? What about my job? What about my relationship? What about the well-being of my life? This is the answer to everything in Christianity. As you draw close to God, you'll find the answers in Christ. You'll find the solutions in Christ. You'll find the life in Christ. It's not just about what happens when you die. It starts right now by drawing close to God. And it's a decision each and every one of us in this room and every person on earth is going to have to make. Will I draw close to God or will I draw away? Because there's nothing in between. But I think you guys are smart in this place. And I think that we're going to choose to draw close to God. Amen? Did you guys get something out of the Word of the Lord today? Hey, before we leave, I want to just ask you, do me a favor. Let me just ask you a real big favor. Just give me a moment more of your attention. Don't get up, don't leave. Don't look at your phones or anything like that. Just Give me a moment of your attention. So important. We talked today about drawing close. We talked about this relationship of getting into Jesus. And it would be a travesty for us to leave today and think or be under the pretenses or the assumption that everybody in this place is right, in the right standing with God. So today I want to ask you a question. I want you to examine yourself like we talked about, that self-examination or understanding or looking into yourself. I want you to examine yourself and ask yourself this question. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a really simple question, and it's a great way to examine or to understand or to determine our position and our standing with God, because your answer has a lot to say with your view and your relationship with God. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think, hope, wish, want, or desire your way into heaven? Man, I really want to go, so God's going to let me go. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope your way into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you you were a Christian, because you were baptized as a baby, you went to church on Christmas and on Easter. Hey, you're even here today, you got a cross or a crucifix around your neck. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you have any of those things, because you've given yourself a title, because your parents baptized you or somebody sprinkled water over you, that you're going to get into heaven? You can't find that anywhere in the Word of God. Oftentimes we think, well, you know, I'm a good person. I don't do bad things. You know, good people go to heaven. You know, I've never cheated on my taxes. I try to help out my fellow human being when I can. You know, I try to do more good in my life than I do bad. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that good people go to heaven, that because of our good works that we're going to get into heaven? The Bible tells us over and over and over again that we are not saved by our works. You see, the only way you and I can get into God's heaven is God's way. And that's the only way. It's God's heaven, it's God's way. We can't do it any other way. Not your way, my way, some well-meaning author or church committee's way. Only God's way. And that is through Jesus. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through Him. So today I want to offer you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your life, and to accept the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church, because you carry the pastor's Bible, because you're involved, maybe you had a membership or a card that says you were a member of a church or an organization, nowhere do you find that you're going to get into heaven because of that. That's talking about following the institution. It has nothing to do with following the institution. It has everything to do with Jesus. Jesus says this in the book of John in the 3rd chapter. He's speaking to a man by the name of Nicodemus, a Pharisee, a religious man, a righteous man in terms of what people would look at and see him. Based on his works, based on his deeds, based on his outwards. And as they're discussing heaven, Jesus says to Nicodemus, you must be born again if you want to get in. What does born again mean? It's not what you think. It's not what Hollywood's trying to make it out to be. It's not what society's trying to paint it out to be. Born again simply means it means that you've given God through Jesus Christ your heart and your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. The Bible says that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know and believe that Jesus is the Son of God, yet they're not going to go to heaven because of that. Why? Because there's a difference between knowing and knowing who. Just let me say it like this. I know the president. I know who the president is. I can tell you his name, but I do not know him. There's a difference between knowing who Jesus is and knowing Jesus. It's an all or nothing relationship. Let me show it to you again in the Bible. Revelation. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation, Jesus Christ is speaking to the church. And he says, listen, I'm coming back. I know your works. I'm coming back. And I'd rather find you hot or I'd rather find you cold. And Jesus goes on. He says, because if I find you lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Ah, shocking statement. What is Jesus saying? He's saying that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. And they'll be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does that mean to be lukewarm? Let's describe that. Let's clarify that today. Lukewarm simply means in terms of your relationship, that you're a little bit in, a little bit up, a little bit down, a little bit out. Kind of occasional church attendance, kind of a roller coaster. Yeah, you know, a little bit of here, a little bit of that. Got some God in you, got some world in you. You know, a little bit of the church thing, a little bit of the world thing. You're riding the fence, not wholehearted for God, not wholehearted against God, right in the middle. We saw that today, that stagnant relationships are actually moving back. Today, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough to tell you the truth today. God, forgive us in the American churches around the world that we've watered the message so down because we're interested in appeasing the ears of the people. But I love you enough, I respect you enough to tell you the truth, to challenge you in your thinking. That it's not about your actions, it's not about your outward appearance, it's not even about your mental ascent towards God. It's about giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life through Jesus Christ. We've already said that Jesus said He's the way, the truth, and the life. We've already seen that Jesus says, I'd rather you be hot or cold. Now today I want to give you the opportunity. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation. Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept the gift. You see, God loved you so much, He gave you a free will choice. He could have designed us all to follow after him, but he gave us the free will decision to accept or to reject his gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. And it's your choice today. But it starts with a right understanding of who God is, like we talked about. He's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to whack you over the head because of the dumb things that you've done. He's not like a little kid sitting on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up, laughing at you because of it. God loved you so much, and he loved me so much, that he gave for us Jesus Christ to die on a cross, a beaten, bloody mess, to hang and to die for our sin and our shame. And in return, he wants all of our heart, he wants all of our life in a relationship, a growing, beneficial, and fruitful relationship with him. And it starts by making a decision. Jesus said these words. He said, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father. But he goes on and he says, but if you deny me, I will deny you. Today I want to give you the opportunity to begin a relationship, a beneficial, growing, and fruitful relationship with Jesus Christ that will change your life, not just for eternity, but beginning right now by accepting the gift. And it starts by making a decision. So I'm going to count three in just a moment. I'm going to go 1, 2, and on the count of three, I'm going to go 3. Smack my hands together. And when I do, if that's you in this place, I'm going to ask you to do something bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing is you're, by the raising of your hand, you're saying, hey, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life today. I want to get right with God. I want to make sure my position with God is in the right place. I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back there. Say, man, I don't know if I can raise my hand, Pastor. Look, I might be embarrassed. I don't know if I can do that. Let me encourage you. I'm not going to embarrass you. But wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm, welcome, and loving place like the church? Let me just be real and challenge you again. If you can't do it in a place like the church, what makes you think that you're going to do it outside the walls of this building? The choice is yours. It's a free will choice. It's not a manipulator, not a conniver. It's not going to force his way or make his way in. God loved you so much, he gave you the choice, and it's your decision to accept or to reject the gift of God through Jesus Christ. And I want to challenge you and encourage you today to make the right and wise decision today. Who should raise their hands in just a moment? If you've never given God your heart, you've never given Jesus your life, if that's you in just a moment, if that's you, pop your hand up when I count to three. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down. Who should raise your hand? Maybe you did this as a child or at a harvest crusade. You prayed the prayer once or something like that, but you never really followed through with it. Maybe you're not sure in this place. If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. Who should raise your hand? If you've been living lukewarm, listen, if you've been running from God instead of to God, you've been doing the religion thing, the rules and the regulation thing. Tell me what I got to do and I'll try to do the best I can. Come on, stop playing games with God today and let's go forward in your relationship with Jesus Christ. Today is your day of salvation. You've had doctors and dentists and DMV appointments. Now it's a divine appointment between you and God. Nothing else in this place matters except right now between you and God. Not the person next to you, in front of you, behind you. This is right now between you and God. The decision to choose life here and for eternity with God. It starts with you. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you, get ready to pop your hand. If you guys in the family rooms out there in the back, I'm talking to you too. I can see you back there in the windows. You guys out there in the foyer, wherever you're at, you hear the sound of my voice. Hey, if you don't even if it's you're at home watching online, right now, it's your opportunity as well. Get ready. This is your moment. Hey, this is your time. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. Let's move forward for God in a warm, welcome, loving place. And we're going to make the first steps now. Choosing life through Jesus Christ. Here we go. Ready? All across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, doesn't matter where you're at, this is your moment. Don't care if you've been here for 25 years or this is your first day. Does not matter. What's important is making the right choice. Today, wherever you're at, here we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands in this place today. All right. 1, 2, 3. I see that hand back over there. 3, 4, 5. I see you guys right over there. 5 wise people. 6. I see you, my man. 7, 8, 9. I got you guys right over there in the back. 9 wise people. 10, 11. I see you guys back over there in the back. 11 of you so far that I see. 11 people. I see ushers pointing. Give me a little wave so I see your hand because I see everybody. Ah, gotcha. 12. 13, I see you back there. 13 wise people. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. 14, 15, I see you guys. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Hey, come on. This is your moment. This is your time. I didn't embarrass them. I'm not going to embarrass you. This is your time to shine. Anybody else in this place today? 15 or so wise people. I'm going to finish it up. I'm going to close it up right now. Anybody else today? Well, hey, praise God for 15 wise people. Awesome decisions. Right on. So now you're making the choice. Now it's time to follow through. to follow through with the decision that you're making right now. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by asking Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, to be the leader of your life. And here's what we're going to do. Just a moment, we're all going to stand. As we do, if you raised your hand, maybe you didn't, but you knew you should have. Hey, shame on you, but it's not too late. As we do, everybody's going to stand in just a moment. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, I want you to get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. Get into the aisle and come meet me here at the altar. If you got family members that came with you, hey, bring them. If you saw somebody raise their hand, hey, come on, I'll go with you. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here. I want to shake your hand. We're going to change destinies together. So come on, let's all stand. Nobody leave as they come forward. So that way we don't discourage them. If that's you, if you raise your hand, come on. You come. This is your moment. This is your time. Come on, wherever you're at.
Jesus, I believe.
Congratulations.
Great
choice.
Jesus, I belong. I belong to you.
Yeah, it's you. Come on.
You're the reason that I live.
Right on, guys.
The reason that I breathe.
You can come. It's all right.
Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah. You can come.
Jesus, I believe.
You guys came. A couple things I want to tell you. Hey, you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. Or you're going to get born again. The first day of the rest of your life is today. Choosing life. Did you know? Let's just think about this for a moment. Let this settle in. You are literally making the very best decision a human being can make. I mean, think about that for a moment. You're pretty smart people. That's awesome. Good job. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? Who's that guy? No, I'm just kidding. I'm just teasing. His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise. I'm the weirdo. You made it through me, okay? What he's going to do is he's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by asking Jesus to be the Lord and Savior. Let's say like this, the leader of your life. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information. As you walk out of here, you're going to say, man, what do I do now? We're going to help point you in that right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to ask you to come on back. He's going to invite you to come hang out with us. We want to get to know you, want to meet with you, and introduce you to a friend that I'll sit down with you right before church to buy you a cup of coffee, whatever it might be, to teach you some things about the things of God so that you get strong in the ways of God. You don't go back to the life that you came from. So if you would just turn to your left, my right, go right over here with Pastor Joel. Right on. Congratulations.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.